His fans call him a reformer, even a revolutionary. His critics say he's guilty of war crimes in Yemen. The 32-year-old Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, Mohammed bin Salman, or MBS, who claims he's cracking down on corruption and championing women's rights, is currently touring the United States. But who's the real MBS? And is the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia really on a path to reform and moderation? Joining me now to debate this are Jamal Khashoggi, a prominent Saudi journalist and former royal family advisor, currently self-exiled in Washington, D.C., who has said the Crown Prince is acting like Putin and becoming Saudi's own supreme leader. And Ali Shahabi, a supporter of MBS, who's executive director at the Arabia Foundation and author of the book The Saudi Kingdom Between the Jihadi Hammer and the Iranian Anvil. Thank you both for joining me on Upfront. Jamal, let me start with you. You've compared your Crown Prince to Putin, to Iran's supreme leader. You've said he's creating, quote, an interesting form of dictatorship. How so?
I still see him as a reformer, but he is gathering all power within his hand. And it would be much better for him to allow a breathing space for critic, for Saudi intellectuals, Saudi writers, Saudi media to debate the most important needed transformation going in the country. What he is doing, I called for, and I got fired for when I was an editor of a newspaper, allowing women to drive or for women to be empowered or to limit the power of the religious establishment. I demanded that, and he is doing the right things. But it is an important transformation that requires all of us to contribute to it, to discuss it, and no one should be jailed for
fair enough, but when you say under MBS's rule, an interesting form of dictatorship is being created in Saudi Arabia, ever since Saudi Arabia was founded, it has been a dictatorship.
No.
Or did that not bother you when you were working
with the Saudi royal family? No. Things were done by consensus within not in a parliamentary system, but throughout the whole family. But as we speak today, there are Saudi intellectuals and journalists jailed. Now nobody will dare to speak and criticize the reform they like.
Okay. Ali Shahabi, he's Putin, he's Iran's own supreme leader. What's your response to Jamal?
Nothing is more difficult and dangerous politically than change, particularly dramatic change. Nobody has been able to carry out dramatic change in the developing world successfully under a pluralistic system. You need a benevolent autocracy. Now, you can open things up for debate, but the question is that history has taught us you never know how far you can open the window before it brings the house crashing down. That's something that all students of history have studied. So he has done a huge amount of things. I mean, people, for example, underestimate what he has done for women and empowering women. It wasn't just women's driving. It's integrating women into the workforce. When women drove in Saudi Arabia in 1990, when the women activists drove, we were both in Riyadh, Jamal and I. And I tell you, the reaction of the religious conservatives went viral. Every mosque talked about them. This time, there wasn't a peep from anybody. So he had to control that.
Why?
Because he has intimidated them, and he threw a number of these religious conservatives and reactionaries in jail for good reason.
So just on the women drivers thing, though, that has been the kind of flagship policy. It's what people in the West have talked about a lot. You mentioned it. You called him a bold leader who's dragging his country into the 21st century. Many would say it's not that bold to allow women to drive in the only country on earth that doesn't allow it. And it's not a sign of being in the 21st century. It's a sign of being in the early 20th century.
Well, yes, previous leaders for the last 50 years.
But your benchmark is previous leaders rather than the rest of the world.
No, you benchmark to your history. You benchmark to what was existing in your country.
So then Kim Jong-un is a modernizer because he's less crazy than his dad.
No, you benchmark Prince Mohammed to his predecessors. You benchmark people to their environment. You benchmark them to their peers. You don't benchmark him to the Queen of Sweden.
Jamal.
No, I want to jump in on the Benevolent autocracy. There is no such a thing as Benevolent autocracy. Autocracy cannot be Benevolent. And lessons of history prove that.
Okay.
One man rule, lessons of history
is always bad. There's an illusion,
by
the way, that people talk about, that Saudi Arabia used to be sort of consensus-driven before. King Fahad, when he took the decision to allow American troops to come in, and that is documented in Western books and in the memoirs of Schwarzkopf. He took it on the spot by himself. He didn't consult anybody. Prince Abdullah, the crown prince, was next to him and was against it. So the monarchs have always been in Saudi Arabia the ultimate rulers. There's this illusion that there was somehow this consensus building.
But that's not the case. But that should not make us accept. I mean, we are talking about a reform that you and I support. And we have opinions about it. For example,
everybody has opinions about it, Jamal. How do you reconcile them?
For example,
how do you reconcile the extreme right wing?
Let's talk about something other than women driving. Neom project, this futuristic city that he is planning to invest $500 billion in it. What if it goes wrong? It could bankrupt the country.
But no one's allowed to criticize it.
But no one allowed to write an objective a piece in any newspaper.
You've written pieces here in the US for Fox News and others praising his reforms. You couldn't write pieces in Saudi Arabia saying whatever you like, could you?
Look, no, you can't. And there's no doubt about that.
But you're okay with that?
No, it's not a question of okay with that.
It
the
is.
Question
that
is
my
no,
question.
No. Give me an example of a democracy in the developing world that can affect change. For example, look at what happened in Afghanistan with Karzai, right? Karzai was supposedly elected. He was not even the mayor of Kabul. He could do nothing in his term. So when he left office, you know, Afghanistan was still run by warlords. It still was a drug-producing center.
Okay, but the Taliban was in Afghanistan.
No, my point is, it doesn't work, unfortunately. Well, and by the
many developing countries who are democratic would disagree with you. But Jamal, you talk about criticism. I want to talk about you. You were a newspaper editor. You no longer live in Saudi Arabia. You've said that friends of yours have been arrested and detained. You've said that friends of yours in Saudi think twice about sharing whatever isn't fully in line with official government groupthink, you've said. Why are you in quote-unquote self-exile? Explain that to our viewers.
Simply because I don't want to be arrested. I don't want to be next to Osama Zamil or Salman al-Ouda. The irony that he has no opposition. Mohammed bin Salman doesn't have an opposition. He doesn't have the Taliban as Karzai have in Afghanistan. Most of the people, most of the intellectuals, most of the people in jail today are supporters of reform. And if they were out of jail, they will be supporting him. There is no need to arrest anybody. And the reason the radicals were strong in Saudi Arabia one day and they objected to reform, because the government allowed them to.
Okay.
What happened in Saudi Arabia today about radicalism, the government unplugged. Unplugged the power of the radicals.
Ali, let me put that point.
But if
Jamal were to go back to Saudi tomorrow and write a piece saying, oh, I think MBS is doing some good stuff, but here's where I disagree with him, and he went to prison, would you be okay with that?
Look.
In the interests of development?
In the interests of development, there may be mistakes made.
No, that's not what I asked.
Yes.
Would you be okay with Jamal?
No, I wouldn't be okay with Jamal going to jail for saying that. No, absolutely not. And I don't think he would.
But you just
see?
Defended the system that would do that.
Because the system cannot be perfect. And the system will make individual
you're talking
mistakes.
It's easy talking abstraction, but I'm giving you a specific
example. No, you're the one
talking
abstraction.
No, I gave you a specific case study.
Because
would you be okay with Jamal Khashoggi, a Saudi journalist?
And by the way, let me just add something. That prison in Saudi Arabia is quite benign. If you visited Al Hayer prison or these prisons, they are nothing like the dungeons of the Middle East.
Saudi Arabia has a history of torture.
It does not have a documented history of torture.
I don't want even to
take a seat in the problem is, Mahdi, you can pick individual examples and mistakes can happen at an individual level. But to affect change in our environment, you cannot do it with an open political spectrum.
But you can't have debate and discussion. You think that one man should be able to make the decision?
No, I think he is having debate and discussion.
You might be wrong.
Now, probably it would be better if we had a wider spectrum of debate and discussion. That's a judgmental issue. And it's very, very difficult for governments to choreograph that perfectly.
Okay.
Because governments, at the end of the day, what you run in this part of the world is the risk of state breakdown.
Okay, we need to move on. There's lots to discuss. I do want to also ask this question about Islam in Saudi Arabia, because one of the things that the Crown Prince has won a lot of praise for, Jamal, in the West, is he said Saudi Arabia would be returning to a moderate Islam that is open to all religions and people. Do you buy that? And do you agree with MBS's claim that Islam in Saudi Arabia was moderate before 1979?
No, Saudi Arabia before 1979 wasn't moderate. Actually, they were a drive for modernization led by King Faisal at that time. And King Faisal brought the Muslim Brotherhood to open up the Najdi hardline school of thoughts. And now we are totally going against that. But that will take Mohammed bin Salman and take us in Saudi Arabia into debating what Islam, what moderate Islam. Saudi Arabia has to be aligned with Islam. The basic law of Saudi Arabia, which the constitution, but we don't call it a constitution because of Wahhabi reservations about the term constitution, we call Saudi Arabia an Islamic state. So what Islam are we going to do? Rather than challenging the Brotherhood, I think Saudi Arabia should work hard into introducing an Islam that is accommodating modernity. So what is that Islam? that require an open space for discussion, an open discourse for discussion to have that Islam. But
give me one example of an Arab country that has opened up the space successfully. It hasn't. But let me go back to the question of Islam. What the prince meant was the trajectory from the founding of Saudi Arabia until 1979 was a trajectory of continuous liberalization and reducing the role of the clerical class. So it had been extremely extreme when Saudi Arabia was founded. And then by the late 1970s, it had gotten much more liberal. Then with the Iranian Revolution, it scared the government.
It's convenient to pick 79 because you can blame it all on Iran.
You allow me to finish my point. The trajectory turns up after that because the Iranian Revolution scared the whole region.
And because you decided to arm the Mujahideen in Afghanistan.
With the Americans, by the way. But the Iranian Revolution sent an example. Sent an example to every cleric in this region that you could take power.
Good.
So it was that trajectory.
That's a nice long answer. You need to answer a question. In the 60s and 70s, Saudi was exporting whatever you want to call it, Wahhabism, jihad, Salafism, etc., to the rest of the world. This didn't start in 79. This was going on in the 60s, in the 70s, during the NASA period. Saudi didn't wake up in 1979 and start sending extremist textbooks around the world. You know that.
No, it's not a question of extremist textbooks.
It is for a lot of people in the West. It's to do with extremist textbooks.
Saudi
for
Arabian,
British Muslims, French Muslims.
The Saudi religious system was ultra-conservative. And yes, in the 50s and 60s, it was...
So it wasn't moderate before 1979?
It was more modern than it was 20, 30 years before. Okay.
Again,
that's what we're talking about.
Again, a low bar. You keep bringing a low bar.
Well, of course, you compare yourself to your history.
Jamal, isn't the problem here that you're saying, OK, after 79... it got more extreme, you're agreeing with Ali. And yet, you're here now in Washington saying, I want this pluralism, I want more dialogue and debate. But where was the dialogue and debate in the 80s and 90s when you were perfectly happy living and working in Saudi Arabia?
No, there was. Look, I got fired from my job twice because I was pushing for reform in Saudi Arabia. It wasn't that easy. But people were not being put in jails. There was a breathing space.
No, you are going through now in Saudi Arabia an intense period of change. The amount of change that has been put in the last 2 years, including subsidies, you see, which affect the man on the street, are you can rock the whole, you can bring the whole system down with that.
We have to move on, but I do want to ask you one question about this.
So it's easy to sit, Jamal, permit me,
just.
It is easy to sit and say we need, particularly in front of American audience, we need more freedom, we need more. These are golden things. Everybody loves them.
Okay,
the question is, you have to be practical.
Let Jamal respond.
You have to be practical.
Otherwise, we're going to run out of time. Let Jamal respond.
I'm not asking for democracy. I'm asking for people to be allowed to speak. This is. I'm asking for the minimum. Yep.
Mohammed bin Salman says Saudi Arabia was moderate before 79. I'm going to bring it back to what it was before 1979, as he said in his 60 Minutes interview. Isn't that a concession that Saudi Arabia has been extremist for the past 40 years, despite all the denials?
It's an expression that Saudi Arabia turned after 1979 into a much more conservative state. It accommodated the extreme reactionary right wing, if you want, the religious establishment, because of that. And he is correcting that.
Okay, very brief about 79. After 79, the government joined hand with the radicals into imposing a restrictive society. Last year, Mohammed bin Salman, thanks to him, unblocked that. If someone to blame for what happened in the last 40 years, it is the government who empowered the conservative clergies to impose their narrow-minded on all of the
sorts. That Prince Mohammed has admitted.
I need to move on. We can't talk about MBS without talking about the disastrous war in Yemen, which he's presided over both as Crown Prince and as Defense Minister. Thousands dead, millions at risk of famine and cholera, the world's worst humanitarian crisis, according to the UN. For this part of the discussion, I want to bring in from New York, Sarah Leah Whitson, Director of the Middle East Division at Human Rights Watch. Sarah, thanks for joining us.
How much
responsibility does Saudi Arabia and MBS bear, in your view, for what's going on in Yemen right now, the violence and suffering there?
Well, I would say that they are responsible for the overwhelming amount of human suffering that we're seeing in Yemen right now. The United Nations has just released updated figures on the casualties there, with over 6,000 civilians dead and attributing over 60% of the civilian casualties to airstrikes, which only the Saudi coalition, and that's primarily really Saudi Arabia, has carried out. The Saudi coalition has imposed an air, sea, and land blockade on Yemen, a country that depends on imports for over 90% of its food, for almost all of its medicines, resulting in the humanitarian disaster that we are seeing now in the country. And I would point massive physical destruction of the country, massive cultural destruction of the country as well.
So, Ali, how do you respond to that? How do you square MBS being a reformer at home while committing what look like war crimes abroad?
Well, there are two sides to a coin. A country does not go to war for fun or for impetuousness, as members of the journalist community like yourself accuse Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia went to war because it felt its security was acutely threatened, which is why countries go to war. It felt that if it allowed what was happening on its southern border to develop, where the Houthis would become a powerful militia like Hezbollah, its security could be existentially threatened. When the Houthis took over the whole of Yemen, they had a vision of Saudi Arabia being turned into another Lebanon. So they went to war. Now, this is a war that has been going on for 3 years. Now, it's a tragedy. Every human casualty is a tragedy. But you said, Sarah, 6,000 civilians, of which 60% have been attributed to Saudi. That's 3,600 civilians killed over 3 years. That has been done in Syria in a week.
First of all, I think Ali is confusing two basic concepts of law. One is the decision to go to war, and whatever reasons the Saudi Arabia government has offered for bombarding Yemen are really irrelevant to the question of the means they've used to fight this war, means that are unlawful, means that amount to war crimes, means that include using unlawful weapons like cluster bombs that we have documented dozens of times that will continue to impact generations of Yemenis to come, means of warfare that have included bombarding schools, universities, hospitals, places of residence, really a wildly indiscriminate, completely unprofessional, despicable
method.
And let me, please don't interrupt me, please, Ali. I know that's a custom maybe in Saudi Arabia, but no, please don't do
it. Well, I would ask you not to insult
Say that after I'm done, Second of all, you must be borrowing your talking points from NGO Monitor in Israel, but also chooses to distract and obfuscate from Israeli war crimes in a place like Gaza by saying, well, somewhere else is worse. Syria is worse, Sudan is worse, and so forth. As you were saying, we're going to compare Saudi Arabia to its own record, to its own standards. And the record and standards of the conduct of its war in Yemen are shameful and despicable. And for a country whose population has long been so outraged by Israeli crimes in Gaza, for you to sit here and try to brush under the carpet the grotesque abuses of Saudi Arabia against the people of Yemen, against the children of Yemen, which has landed Saudi Arabia twice on the Secretary General's list of shame for abuses against children, okay, is really just embarrassing.
Okay. Is this a monologue?
Do you want to respond? You've got some long answers, but you can respond.
First of all, I mean, she exposed herself by saying Saudi reasons are irrelevant.
She said the reason for going to war are irrelevant, which is true.
We're talking about
the conduct of the war. This is a debate about MBS.
There are two things.
I asked a question about MBS's conduct.
There are two things. The conduct of war, when you talk about war crimes, you have to assume that there's an intent to harm civilians. There's not an intent to harm civilians. Well, no, let me finish.
True.
Don't interrupt. You're the one lecturing people on interrupting. Don't interrupt. There is no intent. There's been no evidence to prove that there was any intent. Unfortunately, you are fighting an irregular army that is fighting a public relations war, that situates its material next to civilian houses, that uses schools, that uses hospitals. So you get sometimes stuck. Now, has the Saudi military made mistakes? Of course it's made
according
mistakes.
According to Amnesty and Human Rights Watch, they've deliberately targeted civilians, hospitals,
how do they know
schools?
They're deliberately targeting civilians? How do they reach that conclusion?
So how do you know Bashar al-Assad's different? If you take that argument, then everyone in the world
I know Bashar al-Assad has killed 500,000 people.
Half
a million people.
So he's your benchmark now.
Well, no, he's not my benchmark.
You always use these really weird benchmarks.
No, because I'm saying that in the case of Saudi Arabia,
Hold on. He's a reformer. When I point to alleged war crimes in Yemen, your response is, but it's not as bad as Bashar al-Assad.
Yes.
But MBS is not claiming to be a Bashar al-Assad.
No.
He's claiming to be the moderate Muslim reformer in the Middle East.
I'm saying that they're not war crimes because war crimes, there has to be an intent.
Okay, Sarah.
Let me finish one point.
Finish this point.
There has to be an intent to carry out war crimes. That means that purposefully you wanted to hit a school.
You made that point.
Or you wanted. Well, now
you've made that point. Now
let me finish one other point. Has the Saudi military made mistakes? Of course, it could have made mistakes.
You said that as well, Ali. You said mistakes. You said deliberate. But let Sarah come back in now.
Right.
Hold on.
So, under international law, when you find a widespread and systematic pattern of abuses, you can deduce intent. Not all war crimes require a showing of, say, someone saying something. And again, I should note that the Israeli defense.
Sarah, have you been to Saudi?
Widespread and systematic pattern of indiscriminate targeting is what we deduce intent from, and we've seen repeatedly. When you bombard schools, hospitals, medical clinics, places of residence, repeated widespread systematic attacks on civilian targets, we have investigated dozens and dozens of those strikes, as have other human rights organizations, as has the UN human rights body, and found no military target in the vicinity. Do not tell me that all of the bombardment of civilian targets in Yemen is due to Houthis hiding in the midst. That is the excuse that Israelis use.
So let me. We've run out of time, unfortunately. Jamal, I'm going to ask you the final question. What is the way out of Yemen? You were a supporter of this war, but is there a way that MBS is going to bring it to an end? It doesn't seem like it.
The way out of Yemen is to reach for a peaceful solution that is inclusive, and Mohammed bin Salman, the Crown Prince, must agree to accept the Islamists in Yemen and the Houthi in Yemen and everybody else. He have safeguard Saudi Arabia from a dominance Iranian presence in Yemen is an inclusive, power shared government that includes everybody. We need a democracy
in
the south of our border. But
you need a democracy in Yemen, Jamal. Yemen, you think you can create it in Yemen?
But he's still reluctant to accept the Islamist. He wants to defeat the Houthi and not allow the Islamist to benefit from that.
You made a lot of points. I'm going to ask you a yes or no question to end, since you mentioned democracy in Yemen. MBS is the great reformer in the eyes of some people. Is, on his watch, is Saudi ever going to become democratic? Yes or no?
Not in his watch. I haven't heard him making even the slightest reference that he will open the country for power sharing, for democracy.
I'm going to give you the last word. But Sarah, do you think Saudi's
political reform?
Is Saudi on any kind of reform towards democracy, do you think?
No, absolutely not. Tragically not. And it's really quite an insult to the Saudi people, who are increasingly educated, increasingly articulate, and deserve the right to be able to engage in the political affairs of the country that affect them.
Ali,
that
democratic
is
or not?
Theoretic talk. It's not going towards democracy. Saudi Arabia should go towards better governance. And the whole point about democracy in these countries, it has not worked.
We'll have to leave it there. Jamal Khashoggi, Ali Shahabi, Sarah Leah Whitson, thanks for joining me on Upfront.